In this video, we're looking at speaking activities, and I'm going to share with you 10 of my favorites that I use with my students every year. My name is Charlie, this is Charlie's Lessons, and thank you for coming back to watch another video. Now, one of the most common questions we ask our students before we go into class with them is, what is the area you'd like to improve on the most? And from experience over the last 12 years, there is one winner. The skill that students like to improve the most is not reading, is not listening, is not writing, it's speaking. Now, this probably doesn't come much of a surprise to you, as, for example, reading and listening can be practiced by yourself. Writing is a skill that you can practice by yourself, but you guess you do need a teacher or someone with a higher level than you to give you some advice and corrections. Whereas speaking, well, speaking is kind of difficult to do by yourself. Some people advise practicing speaking when you are on your own, but I always found that a bit strange. Hi there, nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you too.
Where are you from?
I'm from Bath in the UK.
Oh, I'm from Bath too.
What do you do for a living?
Oh, I'm a director of studies at language school in Spain.
Wait, I'm a director of studies at language school too.
Are you making a video for your YouTube channel?
Yes, I'm making a video for my YouTube channel too.
Wait, what's going on? So let's get started with the first activity, which is an activity that I call Truth or Lie. Now, you're probably familiar with this one and you've played it with your students once or twice, I'm sure. This dynamic, though, can be incorporated into almost any activity you do with your students. It doesn't have to be speaking. The way I use this is if I'm meeting my students for the first time, I'll write on the board 5 sentences about myself, and one of them is false. So let's do a little practice together. Here are 5 sentences, and one of them is false. In my next video, I will reveal to you which one is the false sentence. But meanwhile, write a comment below and tell me which one you think is false. When I do this in class, I'll have the 5 sentences on the board and I'll put the students into pairs. They will then discuss which one they think is false and give their reasoning as to why. I will then monitor each pair, making notes of any errors or mistakes they make. And then when we finish a discussion time, I'll then get the students to stand up and give their reasoning as to why they think which sentence is the false sentence. Once the students have chosen their sentence and given their reasoning, I will allow a little bit of time for students to reason against each other if they've chosen a different sentence. Activity number 2 is an activity that is especially useful for teachers who have to substitute or cover other teachers or colleagues that are off sick or are not coming to school that day. So on these occasions, you're walking into a classroom with a group of students that you've never met before, but they all know each other. So what I do is I get students individually to say 3 things about a part. And what I do is that I will give them a point for every sentence that is correct about their partner. But if they give a sentence that is incorrect about their partner, I take a point away. I love doing this activity because it gives me an insight as to whether the students are actually trying to get to know each other or not. If I have a student that gives a lot of incorrect information about a classmate, then I might ask them to sit together during that class. Activity number 3 is an absolute classic. In my classroom, we know it as taboo. All we do is have one student sit at the front of the class with their back to the board and rewrite one piece of vocabulary on the board. The rest of the students have to describe this word to the student sitting down with their back to the board without saying the word. I find it really important that before you do this activity is that you give some students useful language they can use to describe words without saying the word. For example, like this. This language will go on the board before you start the task. Activity number 4 is very similar to the taboo activity we saw earlier. This is because we use the same dynamic. We have one student with their back to the board and the other students looking at what's on the board. In this case, instead of a word on the board, I'm going to play a video. And this video can be of anything that allows the students watching to describe to the student not watching. Recently, I linked this to a topic we were doing in class, which was sports. And I found a video of a series of Olympic sports in action. And the students had to describe every movement and every moment to the student so that they could guess what Olympic sport was being shown. Another twist on this is instead of a word or a video, is to have a picture behind the student. Now you could either freeze a video or take another picture and have the students that can see the picture describe everything they can in 2 minutes. The student that's listening has to then, at the end of the 2 minutes, tell the teacher what information was missing from the original group of students that were looking at the photo. Activity number 5 is one called riddles. What I do is I get inside the classroom before the students have arrived, and I write 1 or 2 or 3 riddles on the board. Once the students are arriving one by one and I'm setting up the class, the students look at the board and they start wondering what the answer is for each riddle. I love this moment and I ask them to do it in English and I listen to them. And at the end of the discussion, I get them to write their answers on the board. I then take a look at all their answers that are on the board and I get them to come up with reasons why they think the answer is correct. For example, I have hands and a face, but I can't hold anything or smile. That's right. It's a clock. It has hands, a face, can't hold anything or smile. A clock can't smile. Think about that. It's really sad. The 6th activity that I want to explain to you is one I call corners. What you do is you tell the students that on this corner of the room is agree, and on this corner of the room is disagree. Then you write a controversial statement on the board and you ask the students to stand up and move to either agree or disagree. I like this activity because it has the physical aspect to it, so the students have to get up out of their seats and move to where they agree or disagree with the statement. So for example, you could start off with a statement that's very, you know, non-offensive, like, you know, should we bring back the death penalty? And then move on to something maybe more controversial, maybe more risque, you know, like, should you put pineapple on a pizza? Before you start this activity, I'd say it's very important that you go through language of opinion, agreement, and disagreement, so that students are clear on how the interactions are going to play out. The 7th activity that I want to share with you is one I call surveys. Now, other teachers might know it as find someone who, or just simple questionnaires. The way this works is that you have the target language and you ask the students to write 5 questions, for example, using the target language. They then have to ask each student in the classroom those questions and then feed back to the class and to the teacher their findings. Now, in today's world, we can create surveys really quickly using an app like Google Forms. And the thing I love about Google Forms is that it gives each student the ability to answer questions in lots of different ways. And also, when the student has finished asking all their questions to the students, the information they get from all the answers is collated in the response section of the Google Forms. And this is perfect for the next stage of a survey activity that I like to do, which is once the surveys are over, not just to put them to one side, but to look at what each student said and come up with some kind of statements that are true for the class as a whole. So for example, if a student's asking, what do you do in your free time? Then you might ask the students, what did the majority of the students say in this class? So for example, 90% of the students will probably say playing video games, and that would be shown in the response section of the Google Form. Activity number 8 is an activity that I call excuses, but it's an activity that I stole. In this activity, I ask the students to line up at the door and ask each one to come up with an excuse on why they should leave earlier than their classmates. Before you do this activity, get them to come up with language of reason, so simple things like because and so, and try and do this after every single class, and you'll find by the end of the year, their ability to come up with excuses on the spot improves a lot. Activity number 9 is an activity that is similar to the previous activity and that we are continuing to develop students' language of reasoning. And this activity is called There's a Monkey in My Bag. What we do is we imagine that each student has a monkey in their bag and has to give a reason why they're carrying a monkey in their bag. Now in this activity I use monkey because it's something quite ridiculous, but the students can choose any other animal or object that might be in their bag and explain why. Usually the more abstract and stranger the object is, the more fun the students have with this task. Here I actually have an example of one of my students doing an activity earlier. Yes, Charlie, what's in my bag? I've got an inhaler because I have asthma, I have got a... What's this called, Charlie?
A bike pump, Pedro.
A bike pump, because I have a bike. And a clock, because I'm always on time.
Oh, for God's sake, Pedro.
The final activity in this video is one called Rank Everything. Now, if you go on the internet nowadays, there is a top 10 for literally anything. So what I like to do with my students is we pick a topic or a subject and the students make a top 10 list of their own. And what I do to make it a competition is I give the students 1 point for every time an item on their list appears on the official top 10 list that I've taken from the internet. And I also give them 2 points if the item that they write on their list appears in the same position as it does on the top 10 official list from the internet. So recently we did ones where we had students from different nationalities in the class, and we had top 10 things that Germany is famous for, or top 10 things that France is famous for. Or another time we did one with our local students, we did top 10 things to do in the city where they're from, in this case, Cali's. So for example, on TripAdvisor, they have a list of top 10 things to do, top 10 restaurants, top 10 bars, loads of things. So once the students have made their list, I then get them to compare with another partner and talk about why they have the same or why there are some missing from one student's list and are present on another student's list. Then we compare all the lists against the official top 10 list, and we then talk about what's present in the list from the top 10 online and what's missing from the students' lists. I remember one particular class where students came up with a list of top 10 things to do in their city, and there were some big things missing from the official top 10 list, which sparked a lot of debate in the class about why it was missing and so on. So there you have it, 10 activities that can help improve your students' speaking skills in no time. Try to incorporate a lot of these activities into your routine in class. That way the students are getting the most practice possible. So I'll see you in the next video, and goodbye.